Hi, Kate. How are you?
Great. Cold and snowy, as always in Minnesota. How are you doing?
Good. Warm and sunny, like this part of the year in Santa Fe. But so what are your thoughts on the Andromeda Strain?
I love the book. I really don't like the movie. I think the book was really good. It was kind of nicely paced, and you can get into it. The movie's kind of drawn out, and I don't know, a lot of science fiction movies age really well, but this one didn't. So I'm a huge fan of the book, but I could leave the movie.
Yeah, so given what you work on, is the Andromeda Strain, would that be your plan for taking over another world?
I mean, given that
you try and build very small things, and so would this be your strategy for intergalactic domination or interplanetary domination?
Absolutely. If I were to send something across planets or across galaxies, I would definitely send spores, and I would probably send a whole library of spores, because Andromeda was so successful because it thrived at the pH and environment of human blood. I don't really know what is the microenvironment of alien blood, so I would probably, seeding the galaxy, I would send out a whole range of spores that probably, that would live anywhere around little acidic to little basic pH and kind of high to low ionic strength of the solution, and just kind of cover all the bases. So I would also kind of fine tune it so it doesn't replicate as fast. So it's like one of this perfect kind of sweet spot between fast replication and lethality, kind of like COVID actually.
Right.
So yeah, that's my master plan.
Right. So you would send a whole ecosystem or a whole ecology of spores, and then you'd tune the sort of all of the contagious properties to be sort of the perfect takeover.
That's the only way to do it, really. If you want to take over a planet, you kind of have to, hit a sweet spot.
I thought we could talk a little bit about some of the things that we talk about all the time, which is ways to build life. New types of synthetic life, how we might take the principles we know from the existing life we already have, or the principles we know in physics, and try and use that to construct, totally synthetic life forms. And I guess my first question for you in that whole world is, if we went back in time to like 1930 or 1940, and we told people then all of the information we'd learned about molecular biology, right? So we said, we've uncovered this entire genetic code. We know, what the encapsulation around cells looks like. We understand this, like all of these really interesting ways in which the DNA gets transformed into functional proteins. And we can sort of fully dissect the cell in terms of exactly what proteins are inside the cell, exactly what genes are there. We sort of have the overall chemical picture of a cell kind of in hand. And then I told those people, and we can't build it. Do you think people would be really surprised? I mean, do you think people in the 30s or 40s would say, once you have all once you understand all the components, you should be able to put it together? Do you think there would be sort of, a gap in surprise there? And what do you think that tells us about biology?
I think they would definitely be surprised, because there is, some people even today are still surprised that we still can't make a living cell from scratch. And I think there is this huge gap in understanding how incredible is the complexity of a living system and how many things have to come together and work together in a way that we still don't understand. So I think if you told someone in the 40s that now we can have a whole list of all the proteins and all the genes in a cell and we still have no clue what to do with it, they would say, you're messing with me. That's not possible. If you have a whole list, you should be able to put it back together. And that's obviously not true, because I think they were missing this huge piece of understanding of what we don't know. And, we're still missing that. We have all the pieces and yet we can't put it together. But that's, in a way, that's actually kind of fun thing about that field, is we know so much and yet we still don't really know much at all.
I mean, part of what's interesting there, I think, is, it tells you that it's, components are important, but dynamics and the right state is also important, right?
Very much. If anything, much more than components, because there's so much variability in the chemical nature of components that make different living cells, and yet they're all doing this one process of homeostasis, growth, replication that we call life. So the way components come together is almost more important than the nature of the components themselves. And that's what makes it so hard.
Yeah, and David and I talked about this a little bit in the last conversation, where we were sort of mentioning that, you know, in bacteria, the expansion of regulatory genes is quite rapid. And that sort of tells you that the cells really care about what things are on at the same time. And if you're
and
not
that's what
careful
we're terrible
what,
at.
Yeah. If you're not really careful about what's on at the same time, the whole thing falls apart. And yeah.
I think that's main reason why we still cannot build a living cell from scratch, is because we don't know how to regulate every single thing. As for example, we can build artificial ribosomes that make the right number of peptide bonds to make a ribosome. So basically, we have a ribosome that's efficient enough to self-replicate, but it doesn't know how to do it in the right order. That's kind of a catch-22, because if you build a system that's complex enough to self-replicate, you've complicated it beyond our ability to replicate it right now. So the simple things are too dumb, and the complex things that should actually work don't work because we don't know how to put them together.
And do you think, I mean, if we went back to those same people in the 30s or 40s, do you think they would be surprised or underwhelmed by the list of components in terms of the number of things in those lists?
They would be overwhelmed, because I don't think people realize that there are tens of thousands of genes in human genome. I think it's just because we weren't aware of the complexity of every single pathway. People didn't understand cells, but the little understanding they had was relatively simple. You know, for example, they knew about Krebs cycle, which is inherently a relatively simple pathway, but then there's just gazillion things going around Krebs cycle to make it work. So I think people didn't quite have a handle on how insanely complex every single subsystem of a cell is, and how much money you have to spend to coordinate between those things. Like you said, cells care about what gets expressed at any given time, almost as much, if not more, than what is expressed. And so that this timing, the temporal control, takes a lot of effort, and a lot of different molecules are involved. Spatial control, that's something that we're just scratching the surface of. The fact that cells are not just bags of proteins, they're incredibly, there's this intricate organization of things inside the cell, and that takes genes, takes proteins, takes other molecules to coordinate. So I think even right now, we don't really know exactly every single of those proteins, what do they do. So in people 100 years ago, or would probably just be blown away by the sheer number of things that are going on at the same time in a living cell.
Yeah, you're right. That is a lot of the history, right? Where people understood how complicated things like us were, right? Yeah. Because people had, you know, done detailed, you know, dissections and anatomy, and they sort of understood that every scale you go down, there's comparable complexity, right?
Yes.
So you have these amazing vascular systems, and then when you break that apart, you get these all these really diverse and specific tissue types. And then when you look at that, you see these really interesting cells making up those tissues, and inside that there seemed to be structure. But
yes.
I think you're right that the history there was that people didn't expect that to go as far down, right, in terms of that complexity continuing down to these really, you know, detailed chemical levels.
I still think we're not done. You know, for example, now those theories are coming up that there is local translation in different parts of a neuron that affects neuronal plasticity and memory formation. The kind of classical as of 10 years ago approach was that the cytoplasm makes proteins and then those proteins go somewhere. Now we think that there's actually local translation at the synapse. So it's not just that a neuron makes a protein and then shuttles that protein where it needs to be. It's actually that the neuron makes a protein in different places, different kinds of proteins in different places inside the same cell. So the more you look at it, the more complex the thing is becoming. And that's just one example of how little we know, and how infuriating that complexity is, because every time we think we figured something out, there's like, oh wait, there's this one more thing that makes it even more complex. I'm sure that's true for you too, because you look at the, you know, physical properties of living systems, and I'm sure the deeper you dig, the more complicated it gets.
You know, and this is something that you and I work on together, but even in these edge cases, like the smallest bacteria, things continue to be surprisingly complex and hard to deal with, right? So even when we've enumerated everything, it's still challenging to figure out exactly what the right state is to get to reboot life, for example, right?
Yes.
Or to build from scratch. And I think it's because even when we have everything enumerated, that state space is still enormous, right? All the different states that those chemicals can be in terms of different concentrations and the dynamics those lead to is still a huge space, right?
Yeah.
And cells have this living state that they like, and then they have all these mechanisms to keep them close to that living state or to help them sort of respond to the environment in or their own internal dynamics in a way that either is homeostatic or takes them to an adjacent living state, right? And that's the end product of a really long evolutionary process that's really tuned all of that. But if we're just searching for that, you know, that state kind of blindly, most of the random things we would try are the non-living state, even with all the right components, right? And that's a really challenging thing, I think, in that whole world. As you and I have been finding out in, you know, different experiments that you've been doing and so forth, right? So
another kind of thing that makes it even harder is those states you're talking about, they're insanely localized. Because if you just look at even a single cell resolution, you could recreate the exact same concentrations of all of those molecules, but if they're not in the right place, they're not, you really don't have that state.
Right.
And also it's so dynamic, as you said, there's transitions between different states that are all alive, and we have no idea kind of what's the dynamic range of life, basically. How far you can go each direction from an equilibrium and still do life.
Yeah, and people have pointed out for a long time that, you know, if you take a cell just after death, right, or a whole body just after death, there's lots of things are not so different, right? Just on the other side of this, you know, this small perturbation. And then the question is sort of what's the key perturbation? What's the system really sensitive to, right? It means that in certain dimensions, it's hypersensitive to certain perturbations that actually will, you know, kill something, which is interesting. So I think you're right. That speaks to that, you know, how hyper-localized life is or the living state is. Yeah.
Yes. It's like balancing something on the tip of a knife, and it can, you know, it can wobble, and then at some point it just drops, and we don't have kind of boundary conditions for that yet, which is kind of sad because I would love to play with that.
And people often see that as sort of pessimism, right, for how life came to be or managed to get more complex, right? And I think because it's, you know, because there are certain dimensions to it that are very fragile, and it's sort of a surprise. And for me, I think the thing I always think about is, but there's huge numbers,
yes,
right?
Exactly.
So one of the saving graces in, say, bacterial life is that you have unbelievably large population sizes, right? Not just in one local environment, one micro environment where cells are actually interacting with each other, you have a huge population size. But then if you expand that out to all environments, you know, you think of the total number of E. coli on the planet, or the, you know, total number of Prochlorococcus, which is the smallest genome that does photosynthesis. There are huge numbers of those organisms. And so, you know, you can have, you know, there's lots that have mistakes and they just die, right? And that's okay. And that, so you're saved by this huge population size, which allows, you know, small selective effects to actually gain a foothold, right? And that's, yeah.
You can extrapolate that all the way back, those population sizes and reactor sizes, to me, are evidence that life is inevitable under the right physical chemical conditions. Because if you have a reactor big enough and all the molecules in it, they're going to stir until something pops out.
You know, I was thinking about, before this conversation, I was thinking about this Feynman quote, which is, you know, what I cannot create, I do not understand.
Yes.
Right. And I wanted to almost take that a little bit further and say, you know, imagine we take the components of the life we know and successfully build that life, right? Then that's one sort of, okay, we think we understand this more now, maybe. But from the perspective of understanding life in general, I guess the question is, do we really need to create radically different life to feel like we really understand life as a whole, right? So if we sort of expand that, what I cannot create, I do not understand, to increase more understanding, do we have to keep trying to create things that are more and more different than the life we already have?
I don't think so. I think if we manage to create life exactly like our modern terrestrial life, just from scratch, from non-living components, we'll learn a ton about about life. I personally want to make as weird life as possible, because that kind of will expand the possibilities and will let us kind of develop new applications and play with what's possible and look for life elsewhere, because it will let us test different conditions. But just for the point of understanding what the hell life actually is, just recreating a cell that operates under the modern terrestrial central dogma will be enough for us to understand what are those essential components, what are those things that are absolutely necessary for something to be alive. And that obviously leads to the question, what the hell is life? And I have no idea, so nobody does.
Right. Great. Well, and I think that was sort of the dimension I was going in was, I think you're right. I think if we put together a lot of components, if we put together the components we have and even can figure out how to rearrange them and do all sorts of things from truly non-living things, and we can sort of, create a very expensive factory for life. And what I mean by that is, like, cells produce new cells at very low cost. Probably the first cell that we create as a, in a lab is going to be like unbelievable amounts of energy and effort to create one cell.
Absolutely.
Right? So a very expensive factory for making a cell. But I just wonder if, so I think we will learn sort of more principles about the life we have from that. But I wonder if we still have this same problem that we're likely to discover life elsewhere that makes us think like, that piece is completely different. And so this thing is less essential than I thought. And then what is the actual generalization or abstraction between these really different types of life? And I wonder, like, what the steps towards that are. Is it just saying, like, okay, now I want you to build a life form, but I only let you use membranes, and you have to come up with your own genetic system. You can't use DNA.
DNA is boring.
Yeah, and you have to come up with your own, like, functional enzyme system. You can't use amino acids. Like, if we do that, will we understand more about life, or are we still likely to be really surprised elsewhere?
I think there is endless possibility for surprises, because every time we build an artificial life in the lab, we have investigated only very tiny amount of the space of possibilities for each of those particular polymers. Even for DNA and proteins, our modern life is not exploring the entire sequence and space of possibilities. So we are a very narrow interpretation of protein DNA RNA-based life. And so if we make another protein DNA-based life, it's still going to be a very special case of all possible ways in which you can do life with those polymers. If we build life from some other polymer, again, we're just going to scratch the surface of all the possibilities. So on another planet, if you have even, a billion years and the right conditions, you can come up with something totally different from the same building blocks, because just the sequence space of the possibilities is so huge that I think we will always be surprised. No matter what we build and what we find, it will always be a surprise. And honestly, if we, go to Enceladus and find something that looks like terrestrial life biochemically, after we confirm that this is not a contamination, and it's actually an independent origin that resulted in a central dogma, terrestrial central dogma like life, that's also going to be an incredible surprise.
Right.
Because that's not what we're expecting. We're expecting something weird and different. If we find something similar, that's going to tell us a lot about the nature of life, because it will point to inevitability of some biochemical pathways and some arrangements happening.
Right.
And, you know, we're already making some of those assumptions. There's kind of a lot of assumptions that we make that are very terrestrial centric. You know, for example, we look at Venus and assuming we did find phosphine there, we say, oh, phosphine means life. Like, no, phosphine means terrestrial life, even if it is phosphine, and that's not even necessary. But, you know, looking for all those things that we consider biosignatures, we only consider them biosignatures because we have some preconceived notion about what life should be, and we might find something completely different, and that will always be a surprise.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. I mean, I think the hard question there is, what does the entire abiotic set look like? Right. And that's a really hard problem because chemistry is such a big space, right? And so understanding like how often phosphine is a true positive and a false positive for life is a really hard question, right? And so I think that's,
And that all depends on how do you see life? Like, you know, phosphine, it can be a true positive for modern terrestrial biochemistry, but what if you went a different route and got a different biochemistry? Then that might not be the case, because I don't think there is any universal biomarker.
Right. Yeah. And I think this is interesting because it also points to the need for us to really continue to build new theories, right? And think of new abstracted theories. And my favorite example, which, you know, other people like to use as well for kind of thinking through this, is sort of the analogy of temperature, right? So what I like to think about there is, you know, there are lots of different microstates in terms of the exact position and momenta of all the individual molecules in a gas that correspond to the same macroscopic temperature, right?
Yes.
So there's, and I think the thing we're ultimately after with life is something like temperature, but we have what we've been able to access because we live at the scales of life and we see it, is we have tons of information about these particular microstates, right? We've learned a lot about the microstate and built theories of the microstate and so forth. And at some point we have to think of, I think, what are the theories for the macrostate? So.
And you can keep increasing that level of macrostate. You know, you can look at an organism as the thing you're looking for, but you can also look at the whole planet. And so you're looking for a biosphere, and that can be something completely different. For example, you can have a biosphere that's made of mycelium, you know, let's say mycelium lifestyle, where instead of individual organisms, you have those giant assemblies of genetics that share biochemistry, basically different genomes inside the same cell. And there's just so many ways of doing life at every level that you know, your temperature analogy is really good when you think about looking for biomarkers too, because for example, if the thing you're measuring is a temperature inside a jar full of gas, you can measure that temperature by measuring temperature of the outside of the compartment too, without even touching the inside. And same for biosphere, what we're looking at is we can look at traces of life that are not actually alive themselves. And there's so many different ways of looking at it that that's actually coming kind of looping back to Andromeda Strain. That's why I think on some level, as sad as it sounds for my plan of taking over the galaxy, that might not actually work, because there are so many ways of doing life that the possibility of developing a pathogen that's compatible with a random biochemistry on another planet is relatively low, actually.
If the pathogen hasn't co-evolved with other forms of life, it's unlikely to be.
I don't think it's possible to make a universal pathogen, because what are you a pathogen for? Like, if your life strategy as a pathogen is to use the resources of a host, you need to know what those resources are. And if you don't, then you can't evolve to be a pathogen for something.
Right.
We see that even on Earth, where viruses don't cross species boundaries all that often. And I just can't imagine finding a polymer system that would be a universal pathogen.
Although maybe being a predator you know, where you just eat something whole and, you know, you trust that there, you know, you trust that you can just digest the energy in that in some generic way. Maybe that works, right? So maybe we should still be more nervous about large aliens that want to consume you whole.
I think what you're working with is the last level of universality we can expect. Things like energy, kinetics, entropy of molecules, that's one kind of level at which I think you can define life. I don't think you can define a process of life and make a universal definition of life on a chemical or biochemical level.
Dave and I talked a little bit about this in the last one of these conversations, you know, about this recent paper that we've written where, you know, we sort of talk about how, you know, there's kind of different ways that we've looked at life in time, right? The first was sort of extant centric, right? So describing the life we see and trying to characterize it and categorize it and think about how it works and what the mechanisms are. And then there was this history centric perspective, which is, okay, now we start to understand this evolutionary process and we understand that there's a long history of life. And then we want to understand, okay, how do you get how do you get the origin that led to all of us? And then this long evolutionary process with sort of phylogenetic trees and diversification and transitions and complexity and other major evolutionary transitions. And then the last way we would say to look at life is sort of this principle-centric perspective, right? Where you say, you know, If I had tons of origins of life in tons of different environments with tons of different evolutionary trajectories, and I did comparative biology on sort of the endpoints of all of those evolutionary trajectories, what principles would I get there, right? And I think that's, you know, I think you're right. That lives more at the level of things like energy and entropy and universal computation and, you know, other things along those lines.
And we're, you know, lowly experimentators like me are limited to what we can pipette. So in a way, I have no way to explore even a significant percent of that space. I can only pipette so much and my molecules can only be complex enough. And I'm also limited by the way I detect things. On the level that you're interested in, you're looking at kind of physicochemical properties, which are objectively definable. For me, as a chemist that tries to make biology, I look at kind of coarse grain properties, like does it make new proteins? Does it eat? Does it maintain homeostasis? And these are things that I measure with very limited set of equipment. So that's kind of another limitation in what we can explore and what we can expect to find elsewhere.
Yeah, and I think those two ends meet somewhere, yeah.
Hopefully, I mean, that's kind of the point of us working together.
Yeah.
But in a way, to me, that's actually exciting and good because that makes me think I'll never run out of things to work on because I'm so inept at what I'm doing that I will never build every possible life form and just say, call it a day, I'm done. I will always have something next thing to do. There's always going to be another assembly, another possible set of conditions to test.
You know, the history of science should tell us that, you know, model systems matter, right? And so I think, you know, in thinking about this sort of principle-centric perspective on life, you know, that we still need a reference point of systems that we can continue to extract principles from, modify, you know, test ideas against and so forth, right? And, you know, without experiments to rule out certain portions of theory, we pray for long periods of time, right? And so I think, you know, physics as an example of a field had a lot of successes because theories could be immediately tested by experiments or observations, and lots of things were held up and lots of things were shot down, and that's how, you know, that's how the sort of next generation of things was able to come about. So.
And that's a nice thing about physics is when you do an experiment, most of the time you get an answer because it's a yes, no answer.
right.
The hard thing about biology is that most of the time the answer is maybe. You know, if you want to build an Andromeda strain, you need a test bed for that. So even if I wanted to make a pathogen for aliens, if I don't have said aliens to contaminate and I don't know much about those aliens, it's kind of hard for me to make that pathogen.
Yeah, so maybe it's back to, you know, lasers and invasion fleets and all of that, right? For planets, yeah.
Or kind, you know, if you're planning on invading something, maybe just put a little more work into it and first find the planet, kidnap a few aliens, check out their biochemistry, and then make a pathogen that is going to work for those particular aliens. I mean, you know, it's going to take a little bit of time too, because you need to know who's the dominant species, because that's the one you want to kidnap and make a pathogen for. Because if you kidnap the hamster and made a pathogen against the hamsters, that would be extremely sad, because Earth would be devoid of hamsters, but that still wouldn't mean we're conquered. So I think there's quite a little bit more work to it than just loading up random pathogens and sending them across the galaxy.
Agreed. Great. So do you have opinions about, for macroscopic, the possibility of macroscopic life, intelligent life, let's say, in the universe? Do you have opinions about whether it's likely to be altruistic, cooperative, or likely to be, imperial? do you have thoughts about that?
My money's on imperial, because everything we know about life on Earth is everything wants to eat things that are slower and weaker than itself. That's if I were to name one or two properties that are general to all organisms on Earth, I would say being as mean as possible is one of the kind of few universal properties. So my guess is, assuming the general laws of Darwinian evolution, the survival of the fittest, the kind of classical way of make more of yourself, assuming that's a universal property of biochemical life, then things are going to be mean.
You know, there's this idea that maybe to get certain levels of technology, you need to have sort of the right kind of information sharing cooperation within a species, right?
Yeah.
And so maybe to sort of make it through some sort of technological bottleneck, you have to become altruistic enough, or you just won't be able to build up enough cooperation. In fact, some ways we see this with, other types of evolutionary transitions, like, symbioses leading to eukaryotes and so forth, right? Where that's a certain sort of reciprocal cooperative relationship. And so maybe to get enough technology to be a threat to other worlds, you actually have to, be cooperative enough within a species to make that happen. And I guess time will tell whether, whether human cooperativity continues to increase and, reach new thresholds of egalitarianism, altruism, sort of all of that, right? Well, time will tell.
I feel like that's true for within the species, but with other species, we're still kind of mean to most other species.
Right. Right.
So, unless we're able to develop enough introspection that recognize that other sentient species deserve respect and deserve the same kind of amount of consideration that we give to our own species, then that may be yes.
Yeah. So your point is, even though we've done all these things, we still have challenges within our own species. And also, the rate at which humans are causing other species to go extinct at present is really high. And for the most part, we don't care. So
exactly.
And so that's sort of, I see.
This consideration for other species and all of that morality discussion, this is so made up. Like, this is so based on the beliefs and what we consider the right thing to do. And that can be so incredibly different if you evolved under another circumstances of if you're just a little bit biologically different. So the likelihood of us finding actual other intelligent life is so low that I wouldn't worry about that.
Right. I think it's a low concern from a practical perspective, right?
Yeah, the intelligent life that's going to kill humanity is humanity. So that's the one I'm worried about.
Yeah, agreed. I think most of our potential for observing other life is likely to be simple, as we've talked about before in the series, and is also likely to be observed from afar, right?
Yes.
And so maybe afar for with low resolution, right? And so, yeah.
Unless we find other life in the solar system, assuming we don't contaminate that planet before we get to study it. But I'm not worried about aliens killing us. I
agreed. Yeah, agreed. Yeah. Yeah, I think you're right. The likelihood of, you know, the overall likelihood is low, and then travel is hard. So
if you put all the resources into intergalactical travel, good for you. I mean, then you've probably, if you're coming with the intention of wiping life on another planet, you've probably earned it because you've put all that energy into getting there.
Right.
I might be talking differently if an alien actually shows up and wants to wipe us out.
But that would just be another one of your, you know, life should continually surprise us, right? So
yeah,
you know, Fermi's where is everyone, right? Is one sort of surprise, and then yeah. You know, now maybe the thinking has shifted the other direction, so that if suddenly there was an observation, that would be a surprise, right? But we should, you know, as you said, we should expect life to constantly surprise us. So
yeah,
great.
What the hell is life? And I have no idea.